quick. Maybe. There we go. Oh. Okay. So before jumping into the four quadrant model, I just want to very quickly look at a couple of the other variations and all of the approaches that the four quadrant model and the other variations that we'll glance over very quickly are really more about organizational and structural integration. It's less about that teamwork and how you make the communication happen, but really more so for the people at the upper levels of organizations to figure out how they can do this at that level. And that's an important thing to consider because clinical integration and team-based care often looks very different than some of the structural models that we use. One of them is a standard framework for levels of integrated care put out by SAMHSA HRSA Center for Integrated Health Solutions. This is from March 2013. It's a fairly long document, and I've only captured a little bit of the first piece, but what it does is it shows you that there are six levels of integration from their standpoint, the lowest being coordinated but minimal collaboration, where you're at separate facilities and you don't communicate much. I mean, you maybe refer back and forth to each other, occasionally send a report, but although we know how hard it is to get records from other places. Level two would be basic collaboration at a distance, where maybe you have the ability to communicate a little bit more readily. Maybe the information does go back and forth in between systems or fax machines. As odd as that is that we still use fax machines in 2020. We also have co-located care, which is, putting people in physical proximity to one another. So level three would be basic collaboration on site. You have, if you're in primary care, maybe you have a counselor on site, or if you're in a counseling center, maybe you have a physician on site, but it's not really tight communication. You don't necessarily have regular team meetings. It wouldn't be considered fully integrated, just that you have some ability to do a warm handoff in the hallway. Level four is a little bit higher than that, so you do have that closer collaboration. It's maybe more than a warm handoff, and you have some system integration. So maybe if there's a counselor on site, they're actually able to do all of their notes within the medical EMR. Then the more fully integrated practices are levels five and six, where close collaboration approaching an integrated practice would be, again, a little bit more than level four, where you have some pretty good collaboration. You probably have regular team meetings. You're working within the same EMR, but it's still two separate practices. And level six would be that full collaboration, a transform merge practice, to where everything is within one entity. It's no longer two organizations just trying to figure out how to make it work, but one organization that makes all of the services available. Same organization, SAMHSA HRSA Center for Integrated Health Solutions, also put out something that compares some behavioral integration principles to PCMH principles. So being able to look at NCQI recognized patient-centered medical homes, and it goes through what the principles are and how health integration actually lines up with those PCMH principles. And because for many medical practices, having PCMH designation is definitely something that indicates that they're doing some pretty high quality work, and I would let the primary care physicians, either on Zoom or in the room, speak to the importance of PCMH more than I do. But it's definitely something that primary care practices want to strive for, and many of them do, and indicates that they're doing some pretty neat things, or hopefully. There's also this resource that's a quick start guide to behavioral health integration. It is just a little online resource that you can click through and kind of helps you really triage, where you need to go based on where you are. It's a neat interactive thing online. And then you even have the American Psychological Association, who's put out some what they consider the behavioral health services, essential components of behavioral health in primary care. But that's really looking at that one version of integrated care where you're taking mental health and putting it in primary care. So they have key features of both that and the care management for people with mental health conditions model. And they're really looking at what are the differences between those and what are the essential components of each. But I said we would focus on the four quadrant model. It is one of the older ones. So the four quadrant model has actually been around for a fairly long time. It was originally used to look at mental health versus substance use treatment and how we better integrate those, because in the world of integrated care, my first variation was let's integrate mental health and substance use disorder treatment. And then at some point they realized, as we need to integrate with primary care, well, let's figure out how to do that too. And it uses quadrants to identify what the services and structure maybe would look like, depending on which model you're in. So at the bottom left is your low mental health needs, low physical health needs. Now your top right is the high mental health needs, high physical health needs. And it's the risk and complexity, you know, just being able to merge those to figure out where we put anyone. But I really hate this diagram because I feel like it doesn't really tell you anything and it's far too many bullet points. So a couple years ago, as part of one of our initiatives, I actually made my own. As part of a MedTap project, I decided that in order to make sense of any of this, we need to take a closer look. I think I blew it up on here. Yeah. So we've got the same quadrants, but we need to figure out what that means. So quadrant one would be your traditional collaborative care model or impact model. So that is the stuff that was developed at the University of Washington. Lori Rainey goes around the country and talks a lot about it, but it's that, how do we do collaborative care for depression or anxiety, which is where most of the research is around, within a primary care practice with a collaborating psychiatrist and then an on-staff behaviorist. So this is your low physical health, your standard primary care practice, and low mental health. So they can use consultation and referral and some collaboration to do that. You would be doing things like ESPRT, which is screening,
brief intervention
and referral to treatment. Wow, I blanked right in the middle of it. And you would want to have a mental health staff person on site, but that might be like that lower levels of integration where it's a mental health staff person, but maybe they're actually an employee of another agency. If we go to high mental health needs, but low physical health needs, this is really where you look at what's sometimes called reverse co-location, which I really prefer to use the terms bi-directional co-location, because there's no such thing as reverse. But what we need to have is we need to have primary care who's able to come to the community mental health center. So much like the practice that Laura is in, where we maybe have higher mental health substance use needs and risk, but there's some physical needs that we can take care of on site, but those patients are really looking at their community mental health center as their medical home. So quadrant three is more, we're still low mental health needs. You've got some depression, some anxiety, but the high physical health needs are more prevalent. So you would still use a traditional collaborative care model. You'd still be doing ESPRT, but you'd also probably be doing some on-site disease health management with a care manager that was looking more at the chronic health condition. So a more of a chronic care model, but then the ability to do some mental health and substance use work too. Quadrant four is another place that you are also looking at, you know, the community mental health center is probably the medical home, unless you can actually get into a fully integrated practice. Because that's where, you know, if you've got high medical needs and high physical health needs and mental health needs, like when all of that is a high risk and high complexity, you want all of those systems to be closely collaborating in a much more intense way than they need to be in any of the other quadrants. And those are the practices that we see that are not as common, but for those patients are going to be the ones that are the most beneficial. And when we don't have that kind of a system and we still have those kinds of patients, that's where we have to start thinking creatively. Like, I don't have these on site. We don't have that kind of a practice. It's not fully integrated. So how do we create a team where one doesn't naturally exist, or where one doesn't, you know, we don't have necessarily the funding to make a team exist, but I know that we need these team members and we have to start being innovative. And we do have a lot of practices across Ohio, and I'm sure people in this room and on the call can speak to some of the ones that we've seen and worked with that have been, you know, doing some pretty cool and innovative things. Actually, some of the things that I know have gone on through Metro and it places up in Cleveland, some of their integrated care clinics are doing some pretty neat stuff up there, also originally funded by MedTap to a large degree. So I'm curious about questions, if people have thoughts or, you know, anything around with these models. It's fairly straightforward. It's just a way of breaking down what the services are, what they would look like based on what your patients look like and what their needs are. And then next week, we're going to talk about risk and liability considerations.